Firing Line with William F. Buckley, Jr. and Staughton Lynd. Tonight, Vietnam. What next?
Staughton Lynd is assistant professor of history at Yale University. And as a scholar, his specialty is the radical tradition in America before 1900. As a citizen, he appears to be concerned to revive that tradition, or as some people might put it, myself for instance, to abuse that tradition. He styles himself a Marxist, pacifist, existentialist, and he is primarily known for his activities in connection with the Vietnam War. Last winter, he journeyed to Hanoi in the company of an American communist official and propagandized for the Viet Cong. Indeed, he is on record as hoping that the Viet Cong will win the Civil War. And he believes that 80% of the Vietnamese would have voted in 1956 in favor of the communist government there. Mr. Lynd is the son of two famous scholars, both of them socialists, authors of the sociological classics Middletown and Middletown in Transition. He is here today to argue, among other things, that the U.S. should pull out of Vietnam and that the Viet Cong should take over the government of South Vietnam. But before we get into the specific subject, I should like to ask Professor Lynd, who does believe that some wars are just, whether he can imagine a situation in which the U.S. would be justified in using military force against a communist power. Mr. Lynd.
Well, in fact, Mr. Buckley, I almost feel obliged to begin by correcting one or two statements you made in your opening remarks, if I may.
Yes, sir.
That is, I don't feel that the purpose or the consequence of our trip this winter was to make propaganda for the Viet Cong. I don't believe I've said that I favored a Viet Cong victory. It is, however, true, as you suggest, that I believe that the course that the United States should now follow in that country is withdrawal. And I feel this, to come back to the question you asked me a moment ago, because I think, in fact, what we have done is to read the situation in Southeast Asia as if it were a military invasion, like those of Nazi Germany in the 1930s, or indeed like those of the Soviet Union in Eastern Europe after World War II. Whereas I am inclined to think that it's essentially a civil war rather than military aggression from without.
Well, I'm glad, in other words, the interview that appeared in the Yale Daily News quoting you as coming out in favor of a Viet Cong victory is incorrect, and
it
I'm very glad to correct
certainly
that.
Certainly is.
So you do not hope for a Viet Cong victory.
That's correct.
What were you doing in Hanoi, which might be construed as might be construed as standing in the way of a Viet Cong victory?
Well, our purpose in going, mine at least, was to try to clarify, if we could, the approach to peace negotiations from the standpoint of the other side. Because there were, and I learned after coming back that this confusion exists in our government as well, there were a series of questions, such as, what do they mean when they say, settle the affairs of South Vietnam according to the program of the National Liberation Front? Do they, in fact, require the physical withdrawal of all American troops before negotiations? There were a series of such questions that seemed to me, and I think to many others in this country, unclear. And my own personal way of dealing with the anguish, which I'm sure we all have about the war, was to feel that as a historian, perhaps I could help somewhat in clarifying some of these issues.
Gentlemen, may we interrupt for just a moment? We'll continue after this message.
Mr. Lynd, were you also misquoted in that same interview, or perhaps a different one, which says, Mr. Lynd said that U.S. brutality in combat and deceit in negotiations were the main reasons of his protest?
I'm trying to remember which speech or interview this was that the Yale Daily News referred to. Certainly the two points that you mention, not perhaps in just those words, but the substance of them, are very much of concern to me. That is, I think that we find ourselves in Vietnam in a situation where, first, we are beginning to use military practices such as torture, and the bombing of unarmed villages that are, I think, somewhat foreign to the American military tradition. And secondly, I think it is simply a matter of public record that our best correspondents, Bigert, Halberstam, and so forth, have corroborated that the United States government has persistently been less than candid with us, the American people, about the situation in that country. Soldiers described as advisors, and so forth and so on.
Well, now, as a scholar, Mr. Lynd, it seems to me that you have been saying a number of things. On the one hand, suggesting that your trip to Vietnam had primarily a scholarly purpose, but on the other hand, suggesting also that you went over there freighted down with a number of value judgments, which as a scholar, it seems to me you ought to suspect. For instance, you say it's not a part of the American military tradition to torture, and you leave an audience thinking all kinds of things. Number one, torture has not been a part of other wars, which is historically incorrect. Number two, suggesting that innocent people haven't gotten killed in other wars, which is historically incorrect. We did more damage in Dresden in 3 days, I think, in 1945 to completely innocent people than we would do at the current rate in North Vietnam over a period of 10 years. And you're also suggesting, as a historical fact, that we are now engaged in torturing North Vietnamese soldiers, and that we are now engaged in wantonly destroying innocent people. Mm. Now, that's an awful lot of value judgment, it seems to me, for a historian to throw out moments after introducing his own credentials as a scholar. How do you manage that?
Well, I'd be glad to present some of the evidence that I had in mind. Now, I don't mean to say that torture or murder of unarmed prisoners is habitual or routine. That it has happened, I think, is beyond question. For example, in Time magazine, August 6, 1965, the 20th anniversary of the bombing of Hiroshima, on page 29, there's a flat statement, the Marines, referring, I think, to the Chu Lai base in South Vietnam, have begun to kill prisoners. As to the question of bombing, I think, again, that it's well established that our bombers do go into villages in South Vietnam on the report of forward observers that the presence of some National Liberation Front soldiers in those villages is suspected. And secondly, that there are so-called free zones, that is, whole areas of South Vietnam within the National Liberation Front lines where airmen are permitted to bomb at will. I just think there's some difference, both in quantity and quality, between these practices and what has existed in earlier wars.
Well, let's leave it that the demonstration has not been made, A, and B, that it certainly hasn't been made with reference to scholarly standards. But then let me ask you this.
Well,
I wouldn't accept that.
I'm speaking here, ad lib, on a television show, but I would say that Professor Bernard Fall of Howard University, for example, has in fact demonstrated by the most rigorous scholarly practices that such things occur.
You mean that such things occur uniquely in the North Vietnamese War?
No, not that they occur uniquely, but that the quantity and quality of American brutality in our conduct of this war is on rather a new scale. I don't think that his scholarly credentials have been questioned.
Well, the question is hardly whether whether they are questionable, but whether or not it is possible to motivate such a phenomenon. What is it, according to your understanding, either as a scholar or as a human being, that would cause the United States, at this point in its rather humane history, to decide to take pleasure from killing people whom it is not necessary to kill in order to advance the strategic objective in South Vietnam?
I think that's the key question, with the exception of the words take pleasure, because I don't mean to imply that. And when I say it's the key question, I mean I think it gets beneath the implication that there's something sadistic or enjoyable to Americans about doing these things, because I don't think that for a moment. I think it's rather that because we are fighting in a situation which we have wrongly pictured to ourselves as a case of outside invasion, but which is not in fact such, And because we are dealing in this case with a communist-led movement which has substantial popular support, and the figure of 80%, by the way, is President Eisenhower's, not mine, that because we don't have the sympathies of the people with us, as we so often have had in our previous wars, therefore we find ourselves driven to these practices, not because we enjoy them.
Listen, Professor, let's stop dropping these little statistical gems around the place. What Eisenhower said when he used the term 80%,
yes,
was that 80% of the people would have joined in any war against the French. He didn't say that 80% were in favor of Ho Chi Minh, and the statistics seem to be so obtrusive as even to occur, to an ideologue. There were almost 1 million refugees who, having tasted the North Vietnamese regime, went down from the southern part to the from the northern part to the southern part of Vietnam in 1954, 1955. So let's be careful about these things. Now,
well, what President Eisenhower said, in fact, in his book Mandate for Change, and I don't have the quotation spread out before me, is that all those with whom he could consult said that at the time of the end of the war against the French in 1954, the end of the 8-year Viet Minh War against French occupation, 80% of the people of Vietnam as a whole would have voted for Ho Chi Minh in an election.
Of course, as an alternative to Bao Dai. Ho Chi Minh had not started his rather systematic euthanasia of people who disagreed with him up until 1954. He was considered the George Washington of that area. There is no question at all but that when the brutality of his regime became manifest, and it was physically manifest to the estimated 60% of the elite class who were liquidated in the ensuing 5 years, that he was hardly a popular hero. He'd only be a popular hero in a world populated by sadists. So I think that these data are extremely deceptive.
Well,
and I worry about the extent to which they seem to work on you.
Let's take another indication from another, I would say, unideological source. Senator Richard Russell, the chairman of the Armed Services Committee of the Senate, said on CBS television, I believe it was last August, in the Face the Nation program, that he felt it was altogether likely that in a free plebiscite in South Vietnam today, Ho Chi Minh would be returned the victor, because his status, Senator Russell thought, was still that, as you suggest, of the George Washington of his people, the leader of their independence struggle, in the popular mind.
Well, in the first place, Mr. Lynd, it's a stupid statement. It's as stupid as saying that the majority of the French would have voted for the Nazis. In point of fact, they did. They wrote the peace, the Vichy peace, with their feet, because the alternative at that moment seemed to be a death. And I have no doubt that there are still a lot of people in South Vietnam, maybe 80%, for all I know, among the faculty of Yale University, who would rather be red than dead. So Senator Russell's statement, if it was made exactly as you quote it, is a highly mischievous one, a highly immoral one, and a highly dangerous one, because it really presupposes that there are rational reasons why people would desire to live under the manifest hideousness of the kind of regime presided over by Ho Chi Minh, which has caused some of the most intensive misery in the post-war history of mankind in North Vietnam between 1954 and 1960. But I wonder why, as you throw around these desultory quotations, why you thought that arriving in Hanoi with a communist cohort and communist hosts, anybody would feel any obligation to tell you anything truthful? Were you in a position where you could actually exercise your scholarly apparatus, or did they simply treat you in Hanoi the way the average observer would have expected that they would treat you in Hanoi? Simply, here is an American idiot whom we are in a position to manipulate because he's an idealist, and we have every we find that we can opportunize on his fine personal instincts and feed him all kinds of trash, which he can then go back and propagandize in the United States. Now, what feeling did you have that you could come to terms with reality in Hanoi?
Well, a number of other private citizens, Mr. Buckley, distinguished newsmen and public figures, Felix Green, William Warby, a British Member of Parliament, Lord Fenner Brockway of the British House of Lords, men whom I haven't at least ordinarily heard referred to as idiots, fell during the year
19... I meant that in the Greek sense, you understand, the moral idiot.
Oh, I see. I'm glad to have that desultory quotation clarified.
In that case, you will agree that green and worthy are of that same category, will you?
Well, I would say, you see, that they were carrying out the traditional function of newsmen to try to go to sources of information. Now, admittedly, those aren't the only relevant sources of information. But on the other hand, sooner or later, if one wants to find out what the other side does mean by its peace terms, one has, it seems to me, to do exactly what President Johnson spoke of on December 20th, 1965, to wit, knock on any door, even the doors of people whom one doesn't particularly like, to ask them, in fact, what their very contradictory and ambiguous statements about troop withdrawal and the political future of South Vietnam mean.
Well, are you willing then to concede that having gone all the way to Hanoi, you came back with empty pockets?
No, I'm not.
Oh, well, what is it that you found out that we were not able to find out through the normal sources, or that in fact the sheer intelligence of our own apparatus was able to tell us, namely, that North Vietnamese are not prepared to suspend the war until they have won it on their terms, or until they find that the prosecution of that war is something that is intolerable? What did you find?
First of all, I think I understand more clearly than American mass media would have led one to understand why it was that the other side was so suspicious of the peace offensive. There may have been all kinds of spurious and devious and hidden reasons as well, but there's one reason rather on the surface of their thinking which I think makes some sense. That is to say, they saw the bombing pause in North Vietnam. On the other hand, they listed to us a whole series of measures of continued escalation in South Vietnam. And they said, in effect, how are we to know which of these two kinds of signal is the true American intention? And so we came back with the feeling, which Secretary General U Thant has since underlined, that the bombing pause of North Vietnam at Christmas time, in fact, did not fully test the possibilities of American military de-escalation as a way of opening the door to negotiations. That if we want to test that hypothesis fully, we will have to try a modest, I don't speak of full withdrawal now, but a modest de-escalation in the South as well as the North. Then I think we can say to ourselves that that signal has gone through clearly to the other side. In addition to that, if I might just quickly finish in answering your question.
Yes, sir.
Seymour Topping, the Far Eastern correspondent of the New York Times, early in February wrote a column in which he drew on our written question and answers exchanged with the North Vietnamese Prime Minister, as well as other sources, saying that he felt that now the North Vietnamese peace conditions were more clear, that it was in fact not the case that they asked the withdrawal of all American troops prior to negotiations, and spelling out in a number of other ways what he said, this by no means ideological New York Times correspondence, was a more clear picture of their peace terms. And I think our visit made a modest contribution to that.
Gentlemen, may we return to this discussion in just a moment after this message.
Mr. Lynd, you call yourself a Marxist. Surely as a Marxist, you don't seriously believe that your little vacation tour to Hanoi would have midwifed some sort of a dialectical reconciliation which would not otherwise have taken place. Surely Hanoi isn't dependent on Yale's vacation schedule for deciding how to press its foreign policy, is it? And I don't mean to say that in the sense of trying to prick your balloon, because I'm sure that you sincerely believe that you had something to do with the crystallization of this theretofore unknown truth. But I am suggesting that your belief in it is a part of that syndrome of unreality that does govern your whole approach to these matters. You do understand?
Yes, I think I do, Mr. Buckley. Let me first of all clarify that what I said in the talk at the request of Yale's chaplain to a small group of students last fall that was described by a newspaper reporter who wandered in unbeknownst to me as the talk in which I called myself a Marxist existentialist pacifist, was that I had been influenced by all of these things, and that as a historian I had found Marxism a very powerful analytical tool. But I don't think any historian, Marxist or otherwise, and certainly not myself, would deny that there are situations where, for want of a nail, a horse proceeds more slowly, battles are lost, kingdoms fall, and so forth. And that therefore no individual in any situation can say to himself that his effort would make no difference. Now, I may have made the wrong
effort. I'm not a Marxist, so I agree with you.
Well, good. Yes. We're on common ground there, then.
I don't doubt that individual people can have an extraordinary influence. If I could harness his energies, I would send the Holy Ghost over to Hanoi, and I'd be quite confident about the outcome. I'm not at all confident, if I may say so, about of the desirability of you and Mr. Aptheker, the communist historian, being sort of a second State Department sent over to negotiate all situations in which we have run into a deadlock. But I do ask you, incidentally, let's not get into the fact that your trip was illegal or get into any of those sort of mechanical disqualifications. I'm sure you're as tired of them as I am.
Particularly since the Supreme Court is still considering the question.
Well, the Supreme Court is still considering every question. it is illegal so long as the Supreme Court doesn't say that it isn't illegal. It is against the laws of the United States. Now, I do wonder, though, whether you would give me an idea, if you will, not of your point of view exclusively as it is used to interpret the situation in Vietnam, but as it is used to interpret the situation internationally. A moment ago you said that you very much resented, or implied that you resented, the Soviet Union's military aggressions against Eastern Europe. You do, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
That is correct.
That is
now,
correct.
Would you, had you known then what you now know, would you have favored American military resistance at the time?
Well, I think that what in fact happened was that the point where the two armies met became the de facto division of spheres of influence after World War II. I would not have favored, I wonder whether you would have favored, American invasion of Eastern Europe.
Yes, I would have.
Mm-hmm. You would have?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, I would not.
No, as far as I'm concerned, I couldn't quite understand the implicit morality in wanting to liberate Germany in order to spare the people there who were intensely suffering under the regime, but all of a sudden be completely unconcerned about people who were suffering 1 degree longitude east of that point.
Would you think that we should invade the Union of South Africa today?
I don't think that it is at all, and I've been to South Africa, I don't think it's at all possible to compare life in South Africa with life in North Vietnam or life in Eastern Europe. I am not aware of millions of people being starved or killed in South Africa. I think I oppose the system of apartheid as earnestly as you do, and I've written against it. Okay. But to suggest that life in South Africa is like life in Czechoslovakia or Romania or Bulgaria after the war is something I wouldn't have expected to have heard from a historian.
I didn't mean to make a mechanical comparison.
You're making an analogy.
I meant to say that I think there are many dictatorships which, in fact, the United States does not react to with hostility, that it isn't only communist dictatorships in Eastern Europe that have been spared, and that we have, in fact, been somewhat selective as to where we intervened, and I was wondering what your criteria were as to what situations we should intervene in and what situations we should not.
I would be delighted to tell you what my criterion is. It's a singular, not a plural. I am in favor of intervention in the affairs of any nation which represents a threat or an extension of a threat to American freedom, and not otherwise. Now, it seems to me clear that by that criterion, intervention in Eastern Europe after the war was most definitely called for, and it was certainly called for, I should think, under the moral inertia of the existing situation. Here, after all, we got into the war in the first instance, or the English did, in order to protect Poland. And Poland was, of course, the last thing that we bothered remembering. But I'm asking you, because I'm interested in you as an individual and you as a generality, how do you view the communist menace, and do you view it as something about which energetic action is called for, even as it was against the Nazis?
I think that since the death of Stalin, the spread have of communism has been primarily through communist assistance and leadership of indigenous revolutions, rather than through the marching of Red Armies across borders. I think this presents a different kind of situation to which we need to respond by different means, and primarily by preventive economic and social measures to alleviate discontent of the kind that Mr. McNamara referred to in Montreal the other day.
Yeah, what would you call the spreading of communism into Cuba? That was post-Stalin by 6 years. Is this what you call an example of communism, communist didacticism taking over the democratic people? Oh, how do you stand on Castro, by the way? Because it might have saved me a lot of time if you were very much against
it. I certainly feel that it was primarily an internal revolution, if that's what you mean, rather than a case of military aggression.
You know, as a matter of fact, it was not. I just thought I'd let you know that. It was not a social revolution. It was a political revolution. And I think that the people who marched with Castro would, every single one of them, almost unanimously confirm me in my own judgment, who then left when it became an ideological coup d'etat. A coup d'etat that was never tested by referring to the people because it would be voted down manifestly.
Well, my own impression, I would like to enter on the record, is quite different. That is, I think that the 12 men or whatever it was who went up to the mountains in Cuba could not have developed the strength that they did had they not offered a program to the peasants as well as using merely political means.
Sure, they offered a program, none of which was carried out. Those parts that Castro went on to carry out were, of course, unrelated to the program that made him such a hero when he took over Cuba on the first of the year 1959. But now, in order not to try to be myself to commit the sin of being desultory, I am anxious to relate your position on Cuba, and I'll give you a hint of what my final thesis is going to be.
Right.
My final thesis is that you have a very dim hold of reality. And that it is that dim hold of reality that relates you, mutatis mutandis, to the people who in the 30s were asking us not to do anything about Stalin, who were asking us not to object to the Stalin purge trials, who were always there to defend the Soviet Union and to urge the American people not to get heated about the subject. If, after all, that human and intellectual phenomenon could have taken place in the 30s, there's no reason in the world why it couldn't take place again in the 60s, and there is no reason that I know of why it couldn't have happened to you, is there?
You know, I wonder if I could ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
Response. And my quotations may be desultory, but I am seeking very hard not to sprinkle epithets, which I think you have once or twice sinned in doing.
Well, I'm not a pacifist. I'm not against epithets.
Well, we were speaking of scholarly demeanor earlier. If you want to say that you're not a scholar either,
I'm
that's
not.
Fine.
Certainly I'm not. Go proceed.
I think we are, however, both attempting to be truth seekers and not to score debating points off each other. And I don't think that the use of epithets and pejorative adjectives helps. Now, the question I wanted to ask you was about South Vietnam today. I have the impression that Marshall Key's government in South Vietnam is an unpopular one. Furthermore, without calling it the worst dictatorship that has ever existed, which I don't mean to imply, that it is a dictatorial one, that there is, for example, a decree now 1 year old which says that people agitating for peace or for neutrality in South Vietnam can be executed for treason, that in fact, three persons were executed near our Marine base at Da Nang last September when they led a small demonstration in that town. I want to ask you what you think about our policy of support for Marshall Key's government. And if a government were to be elected in South Vietnam, as the Buddhists and students are asking for, and that if that elected government were to ask the United States to withdraw so that it could negotiate with the National Liberation Front, what your attitude would be, how you feel we should respond to such a demand?
Well, before answering that question, may I allude to the general, to your introduction to it. You've got to understand, I think, Mr. Lynd, that you do represent the views of so small a percentage of the American people, and you do affront the general views so dramatically that they have got to reach, we have got to reach, for some way of understanding you. Just as, no doubt, you feel that you've got to understand us, the capitalist oppressors, the deceitful Johnson administration, the brutalitarians, and so on and so forth. You tend to use your epithets in a sort of an Aesopian prose. That is to say, when you're insulting me, what you are you do it not ad hominem, but you insult the government and the nation in which I have, from time to time, confidence. So that my treatment of you as an individual is merely a technique by which I can seek to amplify what it is that goes on in your mind. For instance, the very fact that you should now want to focus this discussion on how exquisitely apportioned is democracy in South Vietnam suggests to me, once again, this evasion of reality. Who sat around here wondering whether Churchill was the most popular leader in England during the war? In point of fact, we know that as soon as the war was over, there was a general election, he was ousted. But who sat around here worrying about those things? What they were worrying in England was about the Blitz. What they're worrying about in South Vietnam is how they're going to get food, how are they going to go out and till their fields without getting beheaded by Viet Cong barbarians. This is the kind of thing that they're worrying about in Vietnam. And I don't care at all, myself, whether Key is popular. All I care is that the area be pacified, that it be not added to the communized zone, that we do not betray whatever chance there is for a little repose and hope and decency for these people.
Gentlemen, we must interrupt briefly once again. We'll resume this discourse in a moment.
Miss Lynd.
I wanted to say, Mr. Buckley, that I'm not at all sure that it is the case that the general viewpoint which I represent is quite such a small minority as you suppose. I noticed in this morning's New Haven's Register a Gallup poll which said that 54% of the American people favored United States withdrawal from Vietnam if full-scale civil war erupts in South Vietnam. And therefore, to get to a second point that you made, I think that what happens in South Vietnam needs to be of concern to us, and that when students and Buddhists and others demonstrate in the streets nonviolently, asking not for communism or socialism, but for the right to elect their own government, the United States needs to pay attention to that, and we can't brush that all aside in a way that I felt you were about to a moment ago.
Why didn't we pay attention to the Vichy government? The Vichy government told us to get out of the way, to forget the war, to leave France alone. Would you have taken the position that we should have acknowledged them as the rightful stewards of French destiny, or General de Gaulle, who wanted to save his homeland?
Well, I would have thought that since our concern in South Vietnam is freedom, free elections, democracy, and since that's precisely what these demonstrators are asking for, that it would behoove us to try to respond to their demands as opposed to that of a outright dictator.
Professor Lynd, you can't have democracy without experience. South Vietnam has no experience in democracy. And for them to suppose that they can have democracy tomorrow in the middle of an enormous civil war is something that you, as a historian, ought to be telling them they can't have. This is what they need to know, that elections in wartime are even suspended in the country of the mother of parliaments. There were no elections in England during the Second World War. Why ought there to be some in South Vietnam, which would probably be about the fourth election in its 2,000-year history?
But isn't it really up to them? I think that's
one of the
basic issues between
because
us.
Because you know or should know certain things that
you
they don't know.
You think I should.
Yes, I think you should. I think you should know, for instance, that there has never been a successful democracy in the history of the world that hasn't had a certain amount of experience with democracy. The so-called democratic nations of Africa instantly prove this. We also know that certain people are too volatile for democracy. In my judgment, you can't have complete democracy even in Spain, which is an old civilization. Now, let's hope they get it in South Vietnam. But short of that, let's hope that at least we can spare them. At least we can spare them that hideous destiny of being taken over by the North Vietnamese communists, who would usher in a reign of terror, which we, I think, cannot morally and responsibly allow.
You see, I think that when we were in the position of a colonial country, that other nations made this kind of remark about us, that we were country bumpkins, we were yokels. We didn't have the experience to govern
You're
ourselves.
You're talking about the United States?
I'm talking about the United States.
They call Thomas Jefferson a country bumpkin, a yokel, Madison, Monroe,
such terms
Washington,
were certainly used.
Franklin.
They were certainly used. Now, I don't mean to say that the states of Africa, for example, have had the same degree of preparation for self-government as the 13 colonies in 1776. Of course, they have not. But on the other hand, I think that it is the desire of people all over the world, and I would not be inclined to make your distinction between the volatile and the unvolatile, to make their own mistakes, to find their own way, to learn for themselves. And I just question whether, if in fact a majority of the people of South Vietnam were to ask us to leave, were to say that they wished to negotiate with the National Liberation Front, whether we would have the right to overrule them.
Well, the supreme right is, of course, the safety of the states. That is to say, we have the right, or everybody has the right to commit suicide, as you, or that is one way of viewing the extent of an individual sovereignty over himself. But nobody has the right to ordain another person's suicide. I happen myself to feel that the case would be impossible to make that authorizes a nation to go communist, because in the course of becoming communist, that nation accepts a mandate to communize you and me. Even though you might not feel that you wanted to resist this other than passively, I feel that I would, and therefore my destiny is to a considerable extent involved in South Vietnam, whereas it's not involved, for instance, in South Africa, except in the sense that all of us are brothers and should act in a brotherly way towards each other. But that, I think, is the crucial distinction. And I'd like to remind you that there were saintly, angelic people defending the Stalin trials in 1939, and to remind you that even some of the people that you associate with, for instance, the socialist Mr. David Mac Reynolds, has said about you, as a result of your insistence on a sort of a revolutionary posture as regards human experience, what Lynd has done makes him sound like a member of the old left. This is a socialist speaking, as if he had just emerged from a Communist Party meeting in the 30s with the news that the Social Democrats were the true mass enemy. I insist that to view reality with any sense of perspective, you have got to recognize that for you to be preoccupied with the extent to which Key is a democratic leader and utterly unpreoccupied with the ordeal of North Vietnam and Red China suggests that you are basically dislocated as regards recent human experience.
But you see, you've made an assumption which I don't think is the case. I have, for example, joined other American intellectuals in protesting the recent forced labor sentences for Soviet writers. I don't think it's true of myself as an individual or of the so-called New Left in America generally that it is simply the 1930s in new guise. I don't think there's that same application of a double standard. At least it's certainly not our intent that there be that.
It's a question of perspective, isn't it? Not so much a question of a double standard. I don't doubt that you will protest any atrocity committed anywhere else. But I do know that you spend your energies in such a way as to give a special focus to those discontents, which oughtn't to be the principal discontents of any man whose moral sense of hierarchy is secure.
But you see, Mr. Buckley, the people who are asking in South Vietnam now that we leave are not communists, are not even socialists, most of them. They are Buddhists, neutralists, Democrats.
What Buddhists has asked that we leave?
For example, there's a Venerable Han who's in the United States just now, a 40-year-old so-called Buddhist existentialist and intellectual, one who has organized students in South Vietnam to go among the villages, to try to organize the villagers to combat the communists at the level where the communists score their victories. He says that he feels the United States should leave and that persons like himself should try to negotiate with the National Liberation Front. Now, he's not a communist.
No,
he's a liberal, the kind of person that you and I think, both identify with.
I didn't mean could you mention a single man. I'm talking about could you mention a single leader, a single person who would win any election, because it is a historical fact that nobody of any large following has ever suggested that the United States pull out of South Vietnam. They said, we don't like Key, we don't like Diem, we don't like whoever. But they have never said, we don't like Uncle Sam to be there. You're simply talking about individual philosophers, and you can call them
to say anything. Continue in just a moment. We have just another brief interruption. We will now take questions from members of our audience, and these questions will be directed to one of our two participants. After the answer, if the other party has any further comments to add, we'll be very happy to have them. Our first question from Mr. Tom Ligon, directed to Professor Lynd.
Sir, I have sort of a double-barreled, eclectic question. Would you favor peace at any price in South Vietnam, and or would you favor a Viet Cong victory?
I hope I have a simpler answer. What A.J. Mustey and others who have recently been there say is that the people of South Vietnam, after 25 years of war, are prepared to take their chances on negotiating with the National Liberation Front rather than see the war endlessly continue. They know what happened in Eastern Europe. They know that's a risky course. But as compared to unlimited escalation of the war, it is the opinion of Mustey, Stone, and others who've recently been there that that's what the people would prefer. And I support them in that choice.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Buckley, do you have a comment to answer?
Yes, sir.
Our next question comes from Carolyn Herzog, directed to Mr. Buckley. Ms. Herzog?
Mr. Buckley, if general elections are held in the fall and the Vietnamese people elect a communist government, what steps should the United States institute to weaken and curtail the abuses of such a government?
Well, I think it would be irrelevant to even attempt to do so. We certainly haven't had much success in attempting to regulate the humanity of the government of the Soviet Union or that of China. I should think that if the communists take over South Vietnam, whether through a contrived election or through an act of mass hallucination, which has never happened in any free election anywhere in the United States, or anywhere in the world, there would be something, nothing left to do, nothing left to hope for in South Vietnam.
Professor Lynd, do you care to add anything?
I think that, in fact, the United States has been able to help communist societies liberalize themselves. I think this is what President Kennedy was doing vis-a-vis the Soviet Union in giving economic assistance, in opening up cultural exchanges, in signing a nuclear test ban treaty. And I think that President Kennedy's policy in this respect ought to be continued in the kind of situation you imagine.
Our next question comes from Mr. Thomas Dowd. Mr. Dowd?
Professor Lynd, you speak about negotiations. Now, as an historian, I'm sure you're familiar with the background and aims of Ho Chi Minh, the Viet Minh movement, and now the Viet Cong movement. What do you think these people would be willing to negotiate about, and what do you realistically think that they would concede in good faith?
I think, first of all, that as communists go, Ho Chi Minh has a very good record as a participator in negotiations, that in 1946 and in 1954 he resisted pressure from the left wing of his own party to enter into negotiations with the Western powers. Furthermore, I think that in this situation there are some realistic concessions which they are prepared to make. For example, they told us, at least, and I believe them in this instance, that they are prepared to see a South Vietnamese government independent from that of North Vietnam for a far longer period than the 2 years envisioned by the Geneva agreements, which called for reunification elections after 2 years.
Mr. Buckley, do you have anything to add to the comment?
Well, just this, that it seems to me clear on the basis of the record of the communist states that not that they aren't willing to negotiate, they always are willing to negotiate, but that they are only willing to negotiate if the alternative to negotiation is more painful. There is no doubt at all that they are prepared to make concession A, concession B, concession C, concession D, as enumerated by Mr. Lynd, and absolutely no doubt at all that they wouldn't have been willing to make those concessions A, B, C, D, and E unless we had forced them to do so. The point is to keep the pressure up to the point where they will finally reach concession H, concession H being that the South Vietnamese people don't have to live for the rest of their lives under communist regime.
We have time for one more question. Jeffrey Schiller, question directed, I believe, to Professor Lynd.
Professor Lynd, could you respond, please, to Mr. Buckley's allegations that North Vietnam is some sort of slave state? Because according to Christopher Koch, a professional reporter who visited there last summer, the situation is somewhat different.
That's a difficult question to answer simply. We were there 10 days. We spoke through interpreters. Our access to ordinary citizens was limited. I can give you some of the impressions that we got. Working men with whom we spoke, factory workers in Hanoi and in the provincial city of Nam Dinh, emphasized the educational opportunities for themselves and their children. Peasants to whom we spoke in a village near Hanoi said that whereas something like 1 million people had starved in the last year of the Second World War, now there was no longer starvation in their village. And not making a case for academic freedom, for First Amendment liberties, I'm simply saying that I think perhaps we should imagine that for people who were starving, who had a very difficult situation under the French, their present situation may not seem altogether a step backward. Now, we did ask about some of the atrocities and brutalities that I imagine Mr. Buckley had in mind. The killing of Trotskyists after World War II, which was an example of a political purge, and the killing, the putting down of peasant uprisings in the course of agrarian collectivization in 1955 and 1956. The picture I have, if I have a moment more, on those two issues is on clarity so far as the question of the Trotskyists are concerned. They were killed. Who ordered the killing is unclear. In the case of the peasants...
Gentlemen, I'm afraid we have reached that point where we have to conclude our question and answer period. Thank you very much.
Mr. Lynn, I think the reason they're not starving there is because there's a glut in the capitalist world, but we don't have time to go on except for me to thank you very much for coming.
My pleasure.